afternoon. I'm Sam Keith, and it's been my pleasure to direct the Ideas in Psychiatry program. Ideas, as you know, stands for the Institute for the Development of Education and Advancement of Science. Nicely spelled out Ideas, which was very clever of us, I thought. And it's a part of the Department of Psychiatry at the University of New Mexico. We thank you all for coming. And the program has been made possible by a very generous gift from a grateful family, so that we are able to bring in some of the world's leading scientists, as we have today, and we don't have to charge at all. So we thank you for coming, and we hope that you'll be able to come to many more. With that in mind, what we're trying to do is to take both the department and the community to the next level of understanding about psychiatric illness. So that when we have people here, we ask them to talk to our department, to provide seminars with our students, our residents, and our faculty, so that we all can get well educated about the specialty that they represent. But the different issue for us is we also wanted to bring that to the community. And so we have, in a series of lectures that I hope many of you have heard. Coming up, we have Grand Rounds tomorrow, which will be on the psychopharmacology of treatment-resistant depression, a fairly technical talk that will be geared more at the professional level. We will have Professor David Dunner from the University of Washington, Professor Donald Klein from Columbia University, our own Jan Fawcett, professor at the University of New Mexico, and Professor Mike Gitlin from UCLA. And it'll be a double Grand Rounds running from 10:30 until 2:30 with lunch served in between. So we hope that some of you, if you would like to hear about the pharmacology of depression, will be able to come. Upcoming in our program will be Bill Breithart on January 10th in the Continuing Education Building. And Dr. Breitbart is Chief of Psychiatry at Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York. And he's going to talk on end-of-life issues, confronting our mortality, a crisis of spirit, an opportunity for meaning. Dr. Breitbart is a marvelous presenter, and I hope that all of you will be able to attend that. And then in March, Hagop Pekiskil, who's professor of psychiatry at UCSD, but prior to moving to UCSD, he was for 18 years professor of psychiatry at the University of Tennessee in Memphis, and got very interested in how blues singers captured the essence of depression. And Hagop will be talking on temperament, creativity, and blues musicians at the chemo, and we are hoping to have a blues band to enlighten us after the lecture. Then Dr. Mark Schuckett, also a professor at UCSD, and he has followed a cohort of adolescents for over 20 years, has 2,000 adolescents who have been had issues with alcoholism. And Mark will be talking on alcoholism in adolescence. And in early May, Rosalind Carter will be joining us to talk about her work with mental health issues, social psychiatry, families, and systems of mental health care. And that rounds out a fairly robust program. And now, I'd like to turn to our Chief of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry, and vice chair for the same topic, Dr. David Graeber. David.
Thank you, Dr. Keith. So it's welcome. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Rochelle Gittelman-Klein as our visitor and speaker today. And let me just tell you a little bit about Dr. Gittelman-Klein. So she is currently the Fascitelli Family Professor in Child and Adolescent Psychiatry at New York University. She also directs the Anita Saltz Institute for Mood and Anxiety Disorders at the same institution. And you'll have to bear with my second introduction for you today. She spent some time with the residents and fellows this afternoon. But we're really so pleased to have Dr. Gittelman-Klein presenting. She really, she's a PhD in psychology from Columbia, and really has spent her research career, which has been incredibly productive, in some really important clinical areas that have had direct impact on how we take care of, think about and take care of young people with a variety of psychiatric disorders. And just briefly, she's really done landmark studies with her group following young children that have attention deficit and hyperactivity, and really followed them throughout adolescence and adulthood, and has really informed us about what those psychiatric syndromes look like as people age with them, and some of the challenges and opportunities that people have as they move through their early adulthood and adolescence. And the same area around anxiety disorders, which is the other area in which she's put a lot of her effort and emphasis. So Dr. Gittelman-Klein is going to talk to us today about identifying psychiatric disorders in school-age children and adolescents. The way this will work is she'll present for maybe 45 or 50 minutes, and then, you know, we will definitely open it up to questions. So as you have questions, please keep them in your mind, and you know, we'll have an opportunity to at least get to some of those. So with that, I am very pleased to introduce Dr. Rachel Gittelman-Klein.
Oh, my pleasure.
Thank you very much for this very kind introduction, and thank you for being here. And please try to remember your questions, because that's usually the most fun part of a conference. Okay, here we go. Now, before I talk about how we identify psychiatric disorders in children, it makes sense to say, what do we mean by a psychiatric disorder? What are we talking about? And many of us, not necessarily wrongly, we have legitimate concerns about diagnosing children. There are several reasons for that. One is that we think that there's tremendous variation in normal behavior, and perhaps all we're doing is picking at kids who are just a little bit super normal in a different way, and that they're children who are not going with the flow necessarily, but that's part of childhood. And finally, also, that if we do diagnose them, it will stigmatize them. If a child has X, Y, or Z, then he's labeled, and the label is negative. However, first of all, in terms of normal behavior, some of the things that are not diagnosed are normal variations, such as tantrums in a two-year-old, if a child who's three is upset when his mom leaves him alone, child of four who's afraid of dogs, cats, whatever, or fighting with your siblings. This is not the intent of psychiatric diagnosis. What we try to aim at is diagnosing difficulties, problems, but not classifying children per se. Once we say a child has a psychiatric disorder, that's all we're saying about the kid. We're not defining the person. There's a great deal more about that individual than the diagnosis indicates. But to go back to the issue of labeling and stigmatizing children, I think it's important to remember that whenever it's been studied systematically, it hasn't been supported that by the process of identifying the problems and labeling them, children are not at a disadvantage. Because what happens if a kid has deviant behavior, the other kids, the teachers, the neighbors, your relatives notice. It's the behavior that's stigmatizing, not the label. And I don't know, among your kids, some of them will come home and say, oh, so-and-so is gross, so-and-so is weird, blah, blah. And that's what stigmatizes children, the deviance, not the name we assign to it. So when I speak about identifying psychiatric disorders, we mean that when we do so, there is a difference in the way the child is developing. It's either delayed or it's impaired. And we're talking about normal functions that are not where they should be for the child's age. In addition, this is not an act of will. This is not a whim. This is not something the child can easily control. It's not something you can change by simple environmental manipulation or alteration, such as you're cold, you put on an extra sweater, but if you stay cold, even though you have all the clothes on you, there's something about your thermal regulation, that sort of thing, that you can't just reverse it by doing something relatively ordinary. And what's extremely important is that there's suffering or impairment. So these are conditions that get in the way of the child being happy, the family thriving, and so we want to do something about it. There are real advantages to diagnosis, and at the very least, what they help us do is share a common language. If I say that I've seen a youngster and I think she's depressed, you'll know that this is not a child whose problems is mostly stealing and lying, that there's issues of how she or he feels on a regular basis in her mood. And if we say a child has attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, you will understand that there's a problem in the child's behavior in various contexts, and we'll talk more about that. That's okay, but that's certainly not enough. What we hope to do is that by diagnosing children, we can give them better care. Diagnosis guides treatment. Without diagnosis, you cannot have rational treatment. In addition, whenever parents bring a child for care, they want to know what's going to happen to my kid. What can I expect? That's really important, and you're entitled to know that. If we have a diagnosis and we've studied it, we have some idea about its prognosis, which means its long-term course. And we can tell parents that they can be reassured that this is likely to be transient. Or perhaps you have to prepare for a longer haul. But at least you have some informed communication with the parent about what's to be anticipated. And finally, which is not trivial, if we give up on diagnosis, we give up on knowing more. We can't study something unless we identify it, and we then can see what we can do, what happens to it, etc. If we don't do this, we've given up. So, in brief, it makes sense to identify children who potentially have psychiatric disorders because we can help them and their families. We can make a real difference. We now have treatments that we know work, not for everything, but for many things. And we know that these disorders in children are not innocuous, certainly not all of them, and that they mean future disadvantage unless we do something about them. So there are a lot of reasons why we should bother. How do we begin? How do you sort this out? I mean, somebody walks into your office, they're having trouble. How do you begin to understand what's important, what's not important, what to look for, what to ignore? And there are essentially three classes of function that can help us do this. Usually, people have main difficulties with one of the three areas of development: behavior, feeling, or thinking. Now, obviously, these are not independent. The way you feel affects how you're going to behave and how you think, etc. But usually, there's a core dysfunction that we try to identify. For example, I'm just going to sidetrack a little bit. We're not going to cover all of child psychiatry. It's impossible. We're going to hit on the high notes. I'm going to talk a little bit about behavior disorders and talk about attention deficit hyperactivity disorder as an example, anxiety disorders, and depression. There are others. The previous speaker spoke about substance abuse, and that's extremely important in adolescence, and there are other issues that are important. But we will certainly, they're not as commonly salient as the ones we're going to talk about today. So in terms of behavior, we can think of hyperactivity, inattention, impulsivity, etc. Feelings, we're talking about anxiety, mood, depression. And in thinking, obsessions, delusions. And those we're going to ignore for now. Why is that? Because first of all, these are rare. They're much rarer than the others, and they're more complicated. So we're going to focus on mostly behavior and feelings. The issue is there's enormous variety in how people behave. So when are we confident to say that there's something to the child's functioning that may help us consider a psychiatric disorder? One of the rules, or one of the ideas, is that if the problems occur in not just one setting, but in several settings, in the home, in school, in the community, when the parents go shopping, in church, visiting relatives, etc., if the problems are affecting these multiple situations, functional areas, we feel there's really something to do. If it's just one, it's conceivable there's a mismatch. A child who's perfectly all right everywhere, but in school is having problems, perhaps there's a mismatch with the school, with the teacher, etc. I'm not saying there is, that's all there is to it, but you have to ask yourself the question. If the problem is only at home, but the teachers have never seen it, then you also wonder, depending on what the complaint is, the child can't fall asleep, obviously the school can't see it, you wonder if perhaps there's incompatibility in the child's temperament and the parents. So you get the point that if it's just in one setting, you have to look further for the interaction. And then what we're also very concerned is about the history of the problem. We're not diagnosing very transient problems. Every dog is entitled to one bite. If something happens once or twice, that's okay. But if you have a pattern of the behavior and it's sustained and it's not just past 2 weeks, it's not just yesterday he didn't do his homework, he had a terrible time, let's wait. And if it's sustained, then we're going to look further into it. So in children, we have a tremendous advantage because they're in school. And why is that an advantage? Because school provides a natural laboratory for behavior. In school, the child is with other kids at the same developmental level, the same age, etc., and yet he cannot function the way they do, perhaps. The expectations are the same for all the children. And the teachers themselves have enormous experience, usually, in observing children and knowing what to expect in different areas, socially, academically, intellectually, in following rules, etc. And also, school keep records that clinicians can access and examine to see when it began, how it evolved, what happened over time. And that's enormously informative in diagnosis. Parents, of course, have seen the child, and even much more, they live with him. But parents, understandably, should not be clinicians. They should be parents. And we make excuses for our kids, and that's fine. We give them the benefit of the doubt, absolutely. But that doesn't mean that in all cases that's the best way to look at the child. And so parents' information is incredibly important, it's crucial. But at the same time, the school adds a dimension that parents cannot and should not provide. They don't have another 30 kids to compare to, and they have an investment in that child, understandably. However, at the same time, the teacher reports have been controversial. Often, parents feel that the teacher has it in for the kid, that the teacher is intolerant of the kid, that it's a teacher's problem, it's not the child, etc. I'm not saying this never happens, but when you see a lot of children, you realize that that's unlikely. For one thing, you want to know if other teachers have observed the same thing, if over time the same behavior has been manifest. Also, you speak to the teacher. When you treat children, you have a lot of work to do with the school, with the parents, etc., and you get a sense of the teacher. Does she or he like the kid? Does she understand what's going on with this child? So you can come to a sense of whether that is the case. I want to tell you about an example where teacher information is terribly important, and that's for attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, which we call ADHD. I'm sure you've all heard about it. It's in the media, it's on everybody's mind. And we've done a lot of work with these children, and we've relied on teacher reports. In fact, we request that the school refer the child, not the parent himself. And here are the teacher ratings of children referred, because we diagnose them with ADHD eventually, and their classmates. We ask the teachers to rate an ordinary kid, not a specially well-behaved kid, just a regular kid, and the referred child. And this is the difference in the ratings. I'm sorry, I don't have a pointer, but the first bar is conduct problems. That means provokes other children, is difficult to control, that sort of thing. Two is inattention, and the green is the child who's referred. Three is anxiety, there's no difference. Four is hyperactivity, and there's enormous difference. And five is sociability. Now, here a lower rating is good. The hyperactive kids, and I use hyperactive as a shortcut, are not as sociable. Really, they are in general, but they're not as accepted as the others. So they stay away often. Not pathologically, not deviantly, but they know when to give up. Well, you could say that proves what you've just said, that teachers are biased. They see these children differently. But in these studies, we had what we call blind observers. They're adults who don't know why we're sending them in the classroom, and we just train them to observe children. And we say, you're going to observe this kid and that kid, and that's all they know. And these are their ratings. In the light green are the kids with ADHD, and the light purple are the classmates, the ordinary classmates. And you can see that there's marked differences in interference. By that we mean that the child calls out, he's doing other things than what he's supposed to do, and that's disturbing the class. Off task is inattention, and this is for 30 minutes, so it's not all day, and we don't even know if it's the worst moment of the day. Gross motor is different, but it's not striking, and etc. So when you have children with this difficulty with ADHD, there are marked differences in how they behave in the classroom independent of the teacher's opinion. In other words, this is important. Now, I said in multiple settings, if the teacher says, oh, this child describes a classical child, and I'll give you a vignette of a teacher referral with hyperactivity, impulsive, difficult to control, etc. But the mother says, there's nothing wrong with my child. He's perfectly okay, etc. You see the child in the office, you don't see much. Okay. The other option, the other scenario, is that the parent gives you this litany of difficulties, but the teacher says, I don't see it, and there's no history in school. Well, look what happens to children over time when you have one situation or the other. Okay, here's ADHD. The first row, the first bar, is the rate of ADHD at the age of 18 of children diagnosed at the age of 8. This is the rate in children where both the parent and the teacher reported the same symptoms. This is where the school only, 12% versus 22%, which is different, but it's still elevated. This is the ones where the parent alone said the kid had the symptoms, the school did not. None of them had it at follow-up. And these are the normal controls, which is just within range of zero. So you see, having multiple settings affected made a huge difference for later diagnosis of ADHD. Here's the rate of conduct disorder, and by conduct disorder, we mean aggression, truanting, lying, bad kids at 18. The children at 8 did not have conduct disorder. We rolled it out. This is the rate in those who were hyperactive in school and home, about 30%, school only. There was something there, wasn't there? Home only, not one, and the normals, 8%. If you study the general population, that's what you get of adolescents, because this is 18. So this really brings home that for at least ADHD, there is really critical diagnostic importance to getting information for knowing that the child is affected in multiple settings. And if that's the case, there's really a merit to considering the diagnosis. Another important signal in identifying is a disorder if there's a change in the child's mood. And by the way, when I say change, I'm talking about school age and adolescence. It takes, you know, it's too awkward to say children and adolescents. By child, I mean from, if we say school age, 6 to 18, or school, elementary, junior, high school age. There's a change in the child's mood, his way of communicating, the way he relates, his responses to situations that he's been in before, his interests, his activities, and that persists. It's not just for one day, for 2 days, but it stays. And then you have to be concerned. Now, the change in behavior is most typical for depression and for some anxiety disorders. A lot of anxiety disorders start very early, and the child has always been kind of anxious and then gets worse at some point. But in depression, and even in anxiety, you can have a young person, and I'll show you a case example, who's been perfectly okay and then either becomes depressed or anxious. So if you see a change, and again, not for a day or two, but it stays, you pay attention clinically. Now, some disorders regularly start early, and others not till adolescence. The most common disorder that starts early is ADHD. It typically starts in early childhood and is characterized by inattention, hyperactivity, impulsivity that are excessive, that are beyond the ordinary developmental milestones, and that cause problems. And I'm going to emphasize cause problems, because if a child is overactive, but it doesn't interfere with his learning, with his social relationships, with his behavior in general, so he's overactive. It may be a nuisance at times, but it's not an issue diagnostically. So one scenario is that the child is a nuisance. The child is in conflict in the family, at school, or with peers, and people see him as a problem. In school, he doesn't stay on task, does too much, doesn't apply himself. Then we wonder about ADHD. On the other hand, the child could be a nuisance because he's aggressive, he lies, he skips school, he's not trustworthy, and I've worked a lot with these children, and they can be maddening to the family. And there, we're going to wonder about conduct disorder. I'm not going to discuss it in detail unless it comes up in questions, because you don't need to be a psychiatrist to diagnose it. Your grandmother, anybody can see that this child is difficult. And it's clear that he's in difficulty. So ADHD is extremely important for child psychiatry because it's common. It's one of the most common. About 5% of children have it. When you run a clinic, it's the most frequent reason for referral to a child psychiatry clinic. And typically, when it's moderate to severe, the child is affected in every setting, at home, in school, with peers, with siblings, etc. And it can have long-term effects in terms of continued ADHD, in terms of development of conduct problems of the kinds I've mentioned, and substance use. So it should not be ignored in childhood. And we know, this is so well documented, I could give you a list of references, that we know that ADHD children don't learn as efficiently, that their academic performance is below their capacity, that they have problematic relationships with their peer, they're more often rejected, that they put a lot of stress on their environment, in school, the workplace, or the family. Somebody did a lovely study. He trained child actors in acting like a hyperactive child, a child with ADHD. Intrusive, off task, annoying, etc. And he had adults who were naive as to what the study was about interact with the child. The same children also were told to behave ordinarily with other adults. And after the study was over, after the procedure was over, the adults were invited to a place where they were offered drinks, a kind of, you know, thank you for being here, thank you for helping us out, and they were offered drinks freely. The ones who'd been exposed to the hyperactive actor drank much more than the others. I just said that parents blame teachers, but we all blame parents. On the other hand, having a child who's difficult to control, manage, etc., puts tremendous stress on parents, especially if you have more than one. I remember we've studied hundreds of these children, and there are some that stick out in your mind. This mother who had six children, and the hyperactive kid was the sixth. And she said, if any of the five had been like this, there wouldn't have been a sixth. She was incredibly competent. The family ran so smoothly and beautiful with five, but with the sixth child, it was bedlam. So, you know, it's easy to see how parents don't get it right in handling a hyperactive child, but it's not easy. And those who get it right are extraordinarily talented. It's not something you come to with intuition. You really have to train yourself to do it. Now, in terms of what you look for if a child is inattentive, because you don't think of inattention, you think of, does he make a lot of mistakes that he shouldn't make? Does he not stick to something? Does he not finish anything? You started this and you started that, then you went and you had a bite, but then you ran and you did something else. You worked on your puzzle, but after 2 minutes, you start playing with your truck. And children who have this inattention avoid things that take a long time to do. They hate it. They lose things because they're thinking about something else. They're easily distracted. They're forgetful. So these are the things in children you think of, and then you think it's a symptom of ADHD. We call it inattention. In terms of hyperactivity, it's really what it says. The child can't stay still when he's supposed to. He's restless when he has to stay still. He can't play quietly. And by the way, that's true of adolescents too. But it's less exaggerated. And they're on the go, and they talk too much. They chew your ear off enough already, you know? So that's what we mean by hyperactivity. It's not just moving. There's also an intensity about the behavior, and it's hard to control. In impulsivity, what we're referring to is a kid who's impatient and intense. I have to have it now, you know? This is it. You can't wait. You interrupt. You have something to say. It's extremely important. You're impatient. Now, we all do these things sometimes. Of course we do. But this is a litany. This is frequent. Now, I shouldn't say constant, because what confuses people is that, and parents especially, is that the behavior is not constant. It's extremely variable. At times, kids can be okay, and other times they're off the wall. And then the parent says it's because he doesn't want to. Because when he wants to, he does. But that's not true. That our brain is not built to be the same all the time. Also, attention, activity, etc., have a threshold. There's all in all of us a point at which we lose it. we can't attend anymore, we can't pay attention anymore. And so for some of us, it's very high, and those who have it very high go to medical school. And for those who are very low, they choose other educational trajectories. So the idea is that if you stay at the demands that are low demands, you can do it. But if you up the ante, you can't do it. And that's why most children don't get referred till third, fourth grade, because then independent work is expected, etc. In kindergarten, first grade, you can manage with minimal effort, minimal sustained attention. And if you're a little hyperactive, well, that's okay. You're a child. Second grade, you give the child the benefit of the doubt. Third grade, that begins to be a problem. You have homework, you have classes, you have to take assignments, you have to bring them home. These are very difficult for a kid who doesn't attend. And if you've had experience observing children in the classroom, and I used to interview our observers, is that if, so you're observing two kids, what do you see? Well, one of the kids has his papers all around him, and the teacher says, turn to page XYZ, and he doesn't do it. You know, so there's a pattern of this behavior, which characterizes the child. So as I've mentioned, the ADHD affects a lot of areas, and also some say self-esteem, that's variable, and more accidents. Now, what teachers often say, I don't know why this is going this way now in terms of the slides, what they say is that the child doesn't work hard enough, he's not learning less, he doesn't behave appropriately. Teachers are getting more sophisticated, but it was very rare that they would label the symptom itself. They say the child demands too much attention, disrupts the class, and doesn't complete his work. What we know is that there's more school failure in these children, more required tutoring, more going to special classes, and more of them have learning disorders. The behavior is not secondary to the learning disorder. Even when you take care of that, there still are behavioral problems. They seem to be coexisting, but not dependent. And that's true at all ages, that there are disadvantages with ADHD. That social relationships are difficult because you're too loud, you don't wait for your turn, you're impatient, and you don't go with the flow. That doesn't sit well in peer groups. These have all been very well studied, that families have a lot of conflicts, sometimes leading to divorce. Fathers blame mothers. When I'm around him, he's okay. And that's partially true, because if you're really very stern, the kids control themselves. There's a high price to pay for it, and who can do it all the time? But it's not the whole story, obviously, because in school we have problems. We don't rely on just what happens at home. And also, the kids are in a lot of unstructured situations at home where you can't be on top of them all the time and restrain them. So parents get demoralized. Now, here's a kid who was referred to our clinic by a teacher, and this is verbatim what she said. He requires constant supervision to keep him from disrupting the class. He's stubborn, quarrelsome. Because if you don't go with the flow, you're viewed as that. You can't be with the class, so you look stubborn. He's a short attention span, and that complaint had been made everywhere. He was overactive, disruptive, and impulsive. This was Jim, 6. So another scenario in children, I'm moving on, is that the child is dominated by emotional anguish. His behavior is not problematic as we've described it, but the child is unhappy. Something's going on. Now, it can be anxiety or it can be depression. If it's in childhood, in elementary school, it's most likely to be anxiety, because depression is very rare in pre-adolescence. And there's good evidence that adolescence seems to trigger something, we don't know what, that makes youngsters, adolescents, more vulnerable to depression, especially girls. Girls seem to, at puberty, to switch to being vulnerable to depression. So if it's in children, we are going to think, could it be anxiety? Now, we all get anxious. The question is, how do you distinguish normal from problematic levels of anxiety in young people? And that's not always easy, but let's see if we can sort it out. First of all, it's out of proportion of the threat. What are you afraid of? What is it that you worry about? Your neighbor has a dog, and you've been around the dog all your life, and he's never bitten anyone, but you're terrified. Well, it's not just that dog, but any dog could bite you, but you know this dog won't. So it's severe. It's not just that you're afraid of the dog, but it's so severe that you avoid going to your neighbor. And there are other situations. You're afraid of driving in a car. You could be having an accident. And I'll give you examples of situations that children typically fear. Also, and that's very important, the anxiety is not, the feeling is not flexible. It stays there in the child, even though the child is reassured and you tell them there's nothing to be afraid of. And interestingly, children know this, the anxious children. They know they shouldn't be anxious. And actually, that's a problem that they know it, but still feel anxious because they often hide it. They know it makes no sense, so they don't own up to it. They try to cover it up, especially boys. And sometimes it's very difficult to diagnose anxiety in boys because they will deny the feeling. They'll act consistently with a diagnosis of anxiety. They'll avoid certain situations. They resist going to school. They'll resist going to parties, doing things. Oh, I'm not scared. I just don't like it. They'll make excuses for not doing things. Oh, why should I? The kids are stupid. I'm bored. It's boring. School, I don't learn anything. The kids bother me. They're not nice. They blame situations rather than say, I can't stand it. I'm petrified. So it requires a good clinician to sort this out. And usually, children who are anxious, and adolescents as well, demand a lot of reassurance. What time are we leaving? Are we going to be late? Is anything going to happen? Why isn't Dad home from work? Et cetera, et cetera. And again, the kids know they shouldn't be doing this, but they can't help it. The most common anxiety in childhood is separation anxiety, and it's exactly what it is, separation anxiety. The child is overly anxious about separating from parents or home. And that can have serious consequences. The child won't go outside to play, won't go on play dates at somebody else's house, may refuse to go to school or resist going to school, can't, and this is probably the most common symptom, won't sleep alone, wants a parent to stay with him or her till he falls asleep, has to be in the sibling's bedroom or in the sibling's bed, in the parent's bed, and worries about something happening to their parents. I once saw a little 9-year-old who every night before going to sleep would say to her mother, "Will you be alive when I wake up?" That's really moving to a parent. You know, that child had very severe separation anxiety, but went to school. That's the thing about what I said about inconsistent. This child went to school, no problem, but she wouldn't go in a room by herself in her own home. In other words, anxiety is completely irrational. If she could go to school, why couldn't she go in another room? And so the parents say, she's just faking it. She just wants my attention. She wants me to be there. On the other hand, both parents work. There was no one home. So what's the point of staying home? And in early years, in elementary school, teachers can be mother substitutes to children, so they feel comfortable in school. I'm not saying that there aren't young children who refuse to go to school because of separation, but sometimes the elementary school teacher develops an attachment to that teacher and can function in school. On the other hand, there may be signs of anxiety even in school. So here's a little child, Mary, again referred to us, who was referred because it took her a long time to do things. She was quiet in school and didn't talk to anybody. Now, she was in a home with several siblings, and the parents were very tough. They didn't brook any nonsense, you know, these parents? So kids who are anxious in a family like that are much more likely to hide it. So because she was taking a long time, the psychiatrist saw her, recommended her for IQ testing, and she had a superior IQ. So it wasn't that she was limited intellectually. But when we looked into it further, Mary agreed, she reported that when she was in school, she was very nervous. She was always nervous when away from her family. And she was very ashamed of those feelings. She had never shared them with anybody. And she was paralyzed in school. I can't tell you why, but when kids like that talk to someone that they've had those feelings, there's often a remarkable relief and change. It's rare in child psychiatry that just by owning up to what's wrong with you, you feel much, much better. But a lot of these children have had the burden of the anxiety and the secret. And somehow, there's a cloud that goes away. And they can then examine it and even consider it without having this sense of guilt and shame. And this was the case for Mary. But separation anxiety can start in adolescence too, more unusually, but it can. And this is actually a patient that was referred to us. She was 14, and she'd been fine in every way. She excelled in school. She was very popular, had lots of friends, and she was even enthusiastic about school. But all kids shift schools. And she started high school. And when high school started, she asked to stay home. She didn't want to go to school for the first time. And everybody thought that her difficulties was with the new school. So they changed schools. That's exactly the wrong thing to do, by the way, because new things are anxiety-provoking to anxious children. And she went. She really wanted to go. She wanted to be there. But after an hour or so, she was plagued with anxiety, cried, had to go home. And what was going on is that for reasons she didn't understand, we don't know why it begins, Joan was worried about her parents. She could not control this worry, and she just had to go home. When she was home, she was fine if she was not alone, and that's very common. Children with separation anxiety don't want to be home alone. Alone is awful. Her sleep was disturbed by nightmares, which is a symptom of separation anxiety. Her family was destroyed by all sorts of events, etc. And she couldn't fall asleep thinking about all this. She had stopped to see her friends again out of shame. You were not going to school, you don't see your friends. She stopped calling them, and she spent all her time at home. Needless to say, here the parents had this thriving, wonderful girl till the age of 14, and she was falling apart. So separation anxiety can be very impairing. And if you don't do something, that we know, you're accommodating, and parents do this all the time from the goodness of their heart. They kill the child with kindness, because if you avoid it, then you develop this resistance to fighting it and coping with it. Now that sounds cruel. You have to do it in a humane way, and that's where treatment comes in. But if you allow the avoidance for a long time, that person can isolate herself and then avoid going to college, etc., and you can see. You can make up, fill in the blanks. It's not a good idea to ignore it. Now here are some indications. you know, in school, if your teachers, that the child isolates herself uncomfortably, interacts minimally, though that can be social phobia, and I'll talk about it. And I know, I'm sorry, I'm talking about social anxiety. But anxious kids do isolate themselves for separation anxiety because they're plagued by this internal distress. The other disorder that's fairly common that starts typically in adolescence, so you see signs of it earlier on, is what we call social anxiety or sometimes social phobia. And that's being anxious in social situations. It's an extreme of shyness. Now, being shy is within the norm. Many of us are reluctant in new social situations. We're not sure if we'll handle it well, if we're appropriate, if people will like us. In adolescence, that really peaks. Are you wearing the right T-shirt? Do your shoes the right ones? Is your hair okay? I'm sure you're familiar with that. And they're plagued with, what do people think of me? But if it's, quote, normal anxiety, which can be very exasperating in its own right, the child doesn't avoid doing things, just overly focused on her hair, his clothes, etc., but goes in the social situations. You become concerned when the youngster avoids them, doesn't talk to others, and public speaking is shunned. So if the youngster has to give a report in school, he'll be sick that day. He'll miss school when he thinks he's going to be called on. He hides. Teachers often don't pick this up because they're not a nuisance, these children, and they have other things to worry about. And they don't feel troubled by it. But they should really note it, because often parents miss it. Because here again, the kids make excuses. They can be friends with the cousins. They spend all their time with the cousin. And some people like that, because then they're not exposed to other teenagers who may be drinking or whatever. Let her play with her cousin, you know, that's fine. But in school, this is going to work against the child. And we know that kids like that perform less well in school, have less success in life, etc., more alcoholism, etc. He's shown, 17 years old, also referred to us, described as getting lost in the crowd. He has good grades, well-behaved, keeps to himself. He has had one or two friends since first grade, very uncomfortable in situations where there are large numbers of students, and especially in gym. In gym is also a very sensitive situation. You have to get undressed, people look at you, and kids examine each other in gym. Oh, you know, what is she wearing, she, etc. And so if you see this pattern, it should be a concern. Now, what's common to all children who are anxious, and adults too, is that they're very vigilant. They're looking for danger. They're looking for the next bad thing to happen. So they have a what-if attitude towards life, and it's a hell of a way to live, you know. What if something happens to my mom? What if I don't get good grades? What if this is an A student? I won't get to a good college. You know, this is a seven-year-old speaking. What if we have an accident if we go away on vacation? What if daddy doesn't know the way and we get lost? Typical symptom of separation anxiety. What if I make a fool of myself? What if she laughs at me? What if the teacher doesn't like me, makes fun of me? I'm treating now a college student who, unbeknownst to her parents, did not go to school for 2 months at the end of her freshman year because another youngster had been ridiculed in class, and realistically, she thought this might happen to her. Well, she wasn't going to take that chance. She failed that semester, but that's what's due to social anxiety. She did the work, she handed it in, but in that college, attendance counted. You couldn't pass without being in class, and missing 2 months was beyond the limit. So you can see, and you're not there to see what they're doing. She lied about it, again, hiding out of shame. And when I asked her, well, you couldn't tell anybody, what did you have in mind? She says, I couldn't tell it to myself. She couldn't even own up to her doing it herself because that was even more shameful. So she acted as if she didn't have to go to school. So it can really have serious consequences. And what's also very important, and the what if is due to what we call anticipatory anxiety. When you're anxious, you're not just anxious in the situation, you're anxious because you think it's going to happen. And that's what the what if is all about. And avoidance is, by the time you have a psychiatric disorder, you usually have avoidance, which means that you will not do things that are age appropriate and you should be doing in order to avoid being anxious. Anxiety is painful. Nobody wants to have pain. And kids and young people will go to all lengths to avoid feeling that pain. So they'll avoid going to school, playing outside, taking tests, going to show. They'll avoid taking risks. They'll play it safe, too safe for their own good. Now, another scenario is that it could be depression if there's emotional anguish. And I'll go fast through that because for a long time, we believed that depression was normal in adolescence, that we know adolescence is a period of turmoil emotionally. You change your mood, this is it, I hate it, I'm going to die, blah, 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 a lot of drama. But we now also know that this is not always the case. And here's a cartoon that appeared not very long ago in a New Yorker magazine where the caption says, "Son, it's important to remember it's okay to be depressed. You can see everybody in the family is depressed." Well, it's not okay to be depressed. And also, because we know now there have been some very good studies of children, adolescents who are depressed, followed later on, especially adolescents, where we know that they're socially, they're disadvantaged, academically, they're disadvantaged. It's the second highest cause of death in adolescents. Now, it's very rare because suicide is very rare. So even if you multiply it by two, it's not frequent. I don't want people to get overly frightened, but that's a fact of life, that suicide is associated with depression in adolescents. And indubitably, those adolescents are at much greater risk for depression as adults than those who don't have depression. So it's not okay to be depressed. And what's typical in adolescents who get depressed is that they become irritable, especially at home, less so with their friends. They become impossible. Everything's an argument, leave me alone, blah, blah. They lose interest in many things. They used to read, they don't want to read. They used to play the piano, they don't play anymore. They used to do all sorts of, they play sports. Who cares? I don't like it. I used to, not anymore. Their school grades go down. That's a real telltale sign. If there's a drop in school achievement, you have to look into it. What's going on? Could be depression, could be drugs, but you have to pay attention to it. And there's a change in sleep pattern typically. Typically, depressed adolescents are tired. They nap during the day when they never did. They want to stay in bed. They become indolent. And they find it hard to concentrate. Interestingly, and we've done a study, I've seen about 100 depressed adolescents, they still enjoy listening to music, or they can still enjoy being with friends. And what's confusing in many adolescents is that they can be cheered up, and that also fools parents. She's just giving me a hard time, she's putting it on. And as you can see, I used he for ADHD, and you see she for depression. Depression is much more common in girls. They can be cheered up while friends speak with them, if they hear, oh, there's going to be a party, etc. They can feel fine, but it doesn't last. Then they go back to this pattern of not caring and being indifferent. And that should be attended to also. So we diagnose children and adolescents in what we observe based on what parents see, teachers see, relatives, clinicians observe the child, talk to the child. And there are many things we can do. We can give psychological tests that tell us how bright the child is, how he sees himself, herself, etc. We can use neuropsychological tests that tell us how well the child has can memorize work, can apply things he's learned, attends, etc., motor function. We have neuroimaging techniques for telling us what goes on in the brain in terms of distribution of blood flow, anatomy, etc. And we have rating scales. None of these, unfortunately, are diagnostic. And they may add to our evaluation, but they should not be the basis for an evaluation. Now, rating scales are very important in pointing to what is the problem in school, for example. In ADHD, they're very important in telling us how severe the problems are. Depression scales can be very helpful in helping us understand how strong is the depression. But the scores themselves are not diagnostic, and it's really important to remember that. What's also helpful is that if you think a child is okay, but the depression scale is very high, as a clinician, you look into it further. So they'll guide your evaluation sometimes. But you say, oh, you have a high score. You need an antidepressant. You see what I mean? So you have to be wary of over-reliance on rating scales. And that's it. Thank you.
Are you up for a few questions?
Sure.
Terrific. So as folks have some of the audience, I, since I have the microphone, I get to ask the first question. So I'm very glad to know that sibling rivalry is not necessarily a harbinger of terrible things. I have three siblings, and we have a bit of rivalry, but that's okay. So thank you very much. So one question I had is, would you just speak a bit about what you have learned, both from your studies and other studies, about what we know about attention deficit and hyperactivity as people move into adulthood, and how that might be challenges for patients.
Oh, I don't think. Yeah, I guess.
Okay. First, I guess I should say that it depends on the severity. What I'm going to say will apply to kids who've had it through their early childhood, and it's been a real problem. It's not, I gave you the example, I think it was Jim, the six-year-old. He's really an extreme case, but we have many like him. They're not all as marked. But if the ADHD is severe, it typically continues through adolescence. It doesn't go away in childhood, typically. In our study, over 70% continued to have it in adolescence. In adolescence is a period of stress for all boys, and we studied mostly boys. The reason is that we had 9 boys to every girl, so we didn't have a lot of girls. Adolescence is a period of misbehavior for all boys, and that's why we had 8% of conduct disorder in kids who did not have hyperactivity, because they do silly things, they do foolish things. They want to show off. They do. They're boisterous in public, so they can be stopped by the cops for disturbing the peace. They drink, which leads to further disturbing of the peace sometimes in group situations, outdoors. They will provoke people. They may have fights in public. They will go riding without a license. If they get caught, they'll have an arrest record. But those are incidents. And remember I said every dog is entitled to one bite? But in ADHD children, this happens to a much greater degree and to a more serious degree. So they will get involved with kids who break and enter, who use drugs, if it continues, a proportion. For reasons that I don't understand, and nobody understands, around 16, a lot of them get better, between 16 and 18. And the rate of difficulty drops dramatically into adulthood. There may be residual issues, but you don't have the full complement of these nasty behaviors and these terribly really disturbing consequences. But in the group as a whole, more of the children who had ADHD ended up as substance abusers, having psychiatric hospitalizations, and being in jail. All these hang together. It's the same kids who have these three things. It's not some are hospitalized, some are jailed, some get substance abuse, they develop substance abuse. And those who develop substance abuse, those who were more likely to develop substance abuse are those who develop the kind of antisocial behavior I've described and who hooked up with others like them. So the challenge for parents is to keep their kids straight, to set very firm limits about curfews, et cetera, and to control the social relationships. It's not easy. It's really not easy. I have a very good friend, I went to graduate school with her, who had a son who was like that in terms of hyperactive. In adolescence, he became antisocial. And there was another, and she was extremely easygoing, understood the child, very kind, etc. This is a perfect mismatch, as I said before, of a temperament. She felt if you told somebody, a child, something that was reasonable, the child would listen. Down the block, there was another child, just like this one kid, but the father was a strict limit setter, wouldn't let the kids get away with anything. Both of them turned out exactly the same, both went to jail. So, you know, if we say it's up to the parent, it's up to the parent to try, but it doesn't mean that it's going to work. And you know, we're not God, and it's not always easy to interfere with the pressure of groups. And besides, these kids enjoy it. They enjoy the breaking and entering. It's thrilling. They enjoy the aggression. They enjoy the thrill of all this. So it's hard to interfere with something that gives you so much kick. What do you have instead? You stay home, you do your homework, you know? It's hard to beat. So at the same time, we have most of them do fine, do okay. They may say, oh, you know, they pick jobs that allow them to be more varied in their activities. They don't have to sit at a desk all day, et cetera, but that's fine. And as I mentioned this morning when I spoke to the residents, some of them, one of them I remember well, had a bicycle shop, others started their businesses, that sort of thing. Now, we followed up these youngsters till the age of 41. We finished just last year. The median income, that means half of them made more and half of them made less, in our hyperactive group, was $90,000 a year. In the controls, in their classmates, it was $150,000 a year. Half of them made more. The range in the hyperactive group was from 4,000 to 1.5 million a year. In the controls, it was from 25,000 a year to 1.5 million. So ADHD doesn't doom you to poverty. Most of them were employed, 85% of them. These were all lower middle class parent families. They were not disadvantaged, and it's very important to understand that. And the parents were motivated to get their kids help. So whenever we talk about this, we have to remember that we're talking about a specific group, and I'm sure that you come from such backgrounds. So it's not a sentence to a miserable life, but in some of them, it was, really. And those are the ones who, in adolescence, started going sour, especially substance abuse.
Questions?
I'm going to bring the mic over.
What role does genetics play in this? In other words, grandmother, mother, child?
I'll just give this back to you. Yeah.
Hi. Well, there's a lot of evidence that ADHD is influenced by genetics, by family history. But it doesn't mean that most kids with ADHD have ADHD parents. It doesn't mean that most people with ADHD will have children with ADHD. But when you look at the what we call genetic transmission, it's there. There's no question about it. And it's the single best influence we have identified so far. Family history.
Thank you. I'm curious what you think about childhood bipolar. I understand there's a lot of controversy around whether or not people think that exists or how you separate that out from other types of behavior issues. Could you
Can
speak to that?
Can I ask you a question? What do you mean by childhood?
Like young children. I'm a school counselor, so say school age.
6 to 12?
Sure. Or younger. I mean, I've heard of, I've had the question asked, is this childhood bipolar in like a 3 or 4 year old? And I have heard that there are some who might argue, yes, it is. I don't know. I'm just curious how, you know, what you think about or what the current research is suggesting.
I'll repeat the
I'm
question.
Sorry.
So the question was Dr. Gittelman-Klein's thoughts about bipolar disorder diagnosed in young children, as young as 3 or 4 up through preschool and school age. Does that work?
I think so. Overworks. Well, as you say, it's a very controversial issue. And what do we mean by bipolar? Bipolar is very well has been very well described for over from thousands of years. It's not a newfangled idea. So we have a lot of historical information about what was observed, and even in So what we mean by that are people who go from one mood state to another, sometimes with a period of normal mood in between, and sometimes not. So sometimes you're really depressed, another time you're overly happy. You're so happy that you think everything's going to turn out well, you ignore consequences, and you do the most foolish things possible. I'll give you a very simple example of, and it sounds eccentric, about a young adult who we saw in the hospital, who took a cab to the bank, and he told the, and he got out of the taxi, and the taxi, hey, my fare. He said, wait, and he ran into the bank, took a typewriter. This is long. Went back, gave it to the cab driver. He said, here. Then went to the bank and said, I'm taking money, so that I can go to Washington and shoot Nixon. This isn't. There's this impulsivity that's goal-oriented, that you have an idea, that you know it's a good idea, it affects your thinking, your behavior, everything. But the beginning is the mood, as we say. Now, what happens is that when manic people are frustrated, you tell them, no, you can't take the, you can't have the money. First of all, threatening the life of the president is a federal crime. You can't, when I ended up arrested, you can't take the typewriter. The person will have a fit, will argue, will fight with you, etc. They're very irritable because they have to do what they want to do. This is part of extreme impulsivity. So if kids are very irritable, people say they're manic. It's the equivalent of mania in children. That's stretching it enormously. Because if you leave a manic alone and he can do all the goofy things he wants to do, he's not going to act irritable. There's another guy who was also hospitalized in the same hospital who was very rich. His mother had just died. It's interesting because mania can be triggered by a life event. I'm not saying it's causing it. And his mother had just died. And he went onto one of the busiest highways in the United States, Long Island Expressway, handing $10 bills to the car drivers. You can imagine what ensued. He went to the train station, hopped into a locomotive that was idling, and took it. He did crazy things on the spur of the moment. But when we speak of mania in children, this is not what they describe, this grandiosity, this enthusiasm for what you want to do. They're talking about kids who are chronically irritable and impossible to control. If you want to redefine mania as that, that's mania. But by definition, mania is cyclic, it's episodic. You wouldn't survive if you're a manic all your life. You'd exhaust yourself. You're too busy, you don't sleep. you know, why bother eating? I have something better to do. You don't take care of yourself. You know, there are lots of reports of women who run to the station naked because they wanted to go somewhere, they weren't dressed, they just went. But kids who are described like don't fit any of those descriptions. They're not grandiose, they're stubborn, they're difficult, and they're not episodic, they're chronic. They don't go up and down, they just stay there. They're very difficult, it's very unpleasant, and I'll tell you why it's, I think, key not to diagnose bipolar when it's not bipolar. Unlike ADHD, unlike depression, unlike anxiety disorders, it never goes away. You have it for life. If you have it at 16, you're going to have it all your life. You're going to need treatment all your life. You can't take a chance. If you tell a three-year-old's mother, this, your child has bipolar, and it's not true, what are you doing to this family? Unless you're sure, you shouldn't. And if it's not episodic, you have no right to call it bipolar disorder. Now, in our sample of hyperactive kids, two adults, two out of 207, became bipolar. None of the controls. And it's possible that among bipolar adults, more of them had hyperactivity as children. But it's an infinitely small number. And we'd need a sample of 20,000 to prove it, you know. But it's possible that it puts that people at risk, but they developed it in adulthood, not as children. So that it's possible that ADHD, in some very rare instances, puts people at risk for it. It's not the same as saying they had it then, okay? In fact, that kid, it turns out we had treated with lithium because we thought he was moody in addition to ADHD, and he did not respond. And this is 30 years ago. So I think it's an outrage what's going on now in terms of young children. Now people lump children and adolescents and they give you figures to prove that they're right. That's because they include adolescents. We've always known that bipolar disorder started in adolescence frequently. It's nothing new. But if you put the kids and children together, then you say, see, 20% of them had it. But it's not, I think you really have to make a distinction. Now, that doesn't mean that children cannot have bipolar disorder. They can, it happens, but it's very rare, just as depression is very rare in young children. We don't have an epidemic of bipolar disorder.
We have one more question.
You mentioned a variety of psychological, neuropsychological testing. Does your group do any projective testing, and can you suggest any observations of projective testing in ADHD?
Well, I can give you the short answer or the long answer. The short answer is no, because it's not valid. It doesn't tell you anything you need to know to treat the child. I don't know if you use these tests, so I don't want to discourage anybody, but all the evidence is that they're not diagnostically relevant. Do they tell you something you don't know if you do a careful clinical exam? The evidence is against it. Do they predict anything you couldn't predict otherwise? I'm afraid that's never been shown. So until that's shown, it's hard to recommend that they be used in the clinical evaluation of our children. You know, it's what happens, and I've given a lot of those tests, that they're extremely seductive because you feel you're really getting to something deep. And you may be, but we don't know what to do with it. So it's never been shown that we can make good practical use of it.
Well, before we say thank you, there are evaluation forms out front. We would be very grateful if you'd fill those out. And join me in thanking Dr. Gittelman-Klein for her presentation.
Thank you.